confirmation that Mercury retrograde actually does start this week. But nonetheless, we are very happy to see you on the sunny Seattle afternoon. You are in for a treat. This program is a partnership with Home School, and our featured speaker this afternoon is Min Nguyen, a writer and curator currently based here in Seattle. Homeschool is a free pop-up art school based in Portland, Oregon, providing welcoming context for critical engagement of contemporary art and its issues, which when this idea was presented to me via my colleague Amanda Donnan, the curator here at the Fry, was a very sort of obvious no-brainer thing that we should do. So we're very happy to have Homeschool and Min Nguyen here in the house this afternoon, and we're very happy to see you guys. And without further ado, Min Nguyen.
I can if you want.
Yeah.
Okay. Min wants me to talk.
Can you blame her?
I thought you were going to introduce Homeschool.
Sure. So as Nagar said, Homeschool is a free pop-up art school in Portland. We have a multimedia curriculum of classes, panels, poetry readings, exhibitions, performance and sound events, and other things. We're interested in pedagogy based in the casual rigor of the etymology of school, which is from the Greek schole, meaning rest, leisure, idleness, free time. And this is the first talk of the 2018 curriculum, our third year of programming. We're really excited to have Min. I don't want to say anything else about this coming year, but we've got some big things happening, both in Seattle and Portland, so I hope to see you guys at more events. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out tonight, or today on this sunny Sunday. I'm Min. I was really thrilled when Manny asked me to do homeschool because it's one of my favorite art programs. I see them ask very hard questions, and I also think it's super fun. It's kind of that casual rigor, like Manny was saying. And the other, this is an okay volume. Okay. The other ones that I've gone to are like super informal too, which I really liked. And feel kind of self-conscious about the venue that we chose because this seems really formal. And I think I would like it if you just imagined that we were sitting in a big circle and I was like on third tier. So I wanted to say that because even though I'm on a podium, I am not an expert in any of these subjects. So I'm going to talk about, these are a bunch of notes that I've gathered on some things that have interested me for a really long time. And this talk is an attempt to draw connections between them, whether they exist or not. For those who don't know me, I'm a local writer and curator and a budding art historian. I say budding because art historian seems like a hard claim to make if you don't have a PhD or a published book. And I don't have an interest in either of those and feel like I don't have an attention span for either. So I also feel like allergic to professionalism and the mystification that happens around academics. So I'm trying to figure out what being like a casual art historian means for me. And I will preface to say that I'm less interested in art movements and the techniques contained within them than I am in international political ramifications in culture and aesthetics. I'm interested in how images are products of modern imagination, how they're interconnected, and how they're connected with many other images that other modern imaginations produced. The functioning of these modern imaginations are more interesting to me than any individual art movements by themselves. The research that I'm sharing is personal and self-indulgent, just like a lot of research. As a person working in the arts, I'm met with pushback from my family from Vietnam who can't imagine that art is not facilitated by government or doesn't serve governmental purposes. And so that sort of was the beginning of my inquiry. I wanted to look at the historical relation between Vietnamese people and what we think of art, which is contained largely in all of my work. So questions that vex me are mainly around identity formation, about when political regimes play art director, how political regimes evaluate the ideological promises of art and formulate art movements for social engineering. Some questions that might come out of this talk are, what could post-communist art look like? in the examples I show, there's sort of a Frankensteining that happens, just like there's a Frankensteining of mixed economies that happens when post-communist countries enter global economies. There's sort of a similar thing that happens with art history. As the opening of communist countries has meant for their populations a sudden necessity of surviving under new economic pressures dictated by international markets, focusing on Vietnam and these Vietnamese artists, I'll look at how art transitions in former communist states to new governments aimed to create free market-oriented capitalist economies. And given that Vietnam is emerging as one of Asia's fastest growing economies, many curators, collectors, and investors are scouring the country. So I'm sort of interested in that like proliferation of like different art histories all entering the country at once. And specifically with Vietnam, during Ho Chi Minh's Communist Party formed its parameters of art specifically around an antagonism to US imperialism, I find it interesting that after the period of reformation, contemporary artists and curators are now encouraging current artists there to make work for the global art market, which is interpreted in styles of what Alex Rubin and David Levine call international art English, contemporary art's particular non-local language that is supposed to be international but has axes pointing to the West. So today I'm primarily sharing historical notes. There are big questions that arise out of all of this that I won't be answering, but I will burden you with if you so choose. How can a society value art as a form of individual expression as well as value egalitarianism and the collective? Art historian Boris Groys writes, "We are all aware of the fact that our civilization is based on inequality, but we tend to think that this inequality should be corrected by upward mobility, by letting people realize their talents, their gifts. In other words, we are ready to protest against the inequality dictated by the existing systems of power, but at the same time, we are ready to accept the notion of unequal distribution of natural gifts and talents. However, it is obvious that the belief in natural gifts and creativity is the worst form of social Darwinism, and actually neoliberalism, and with its notions of human capital. So that's to ask, can there be freedom of creative expression and communism, like functionally and ideologically? There's this picture that circulates on social media of an unattributed quote. It reads, if it's inaccessible to the poor, it's neither radical nor revolutionary, if you've seen it. And I'm interested in how this quote circulates and how it means a lot of different things to different people with very opposing viewpoints. And this talk is sort of one way of looking at how different people interpreted that quote. Because the communist ideology that Ho Chi Minh facilitated was influenced by the Soviet Union's, particularly around art's role in society, I'll start with Stalinist socialist realism and its guiding principles. So in 1932, Stalin gave a speech to a group of writers in Moscow at Maxim Gorky's home, and he said, "The artist must first give priority to the truthful presentation of life, and if he truly portrays our life, then he cannot but show that it leads to socialism. This will be socialist art. This will be socialist realism." He also makes a point to say that socialist realism is realistic in form and socialist in content. Many of you already probably know about this genre, but to some, socialist realism is about accessibility and form. It's about optimism. It has really distinct parts, which are proletarian, typical, realistic, and partisan. It was formed out of rejection of the existing art forms at the time, such as the Russian avant-garde, which was seen as nihilistic and pessimistic. It was against modernist formal interpretation and the avant-garde's abandonment of what they saw as the public and an abandonment of bourgeois decadence. It was against painterly innovation from the School of Paris. Like Russian futurism, Soviet art believed communism required a complete rupture from the past, so it was timeless, placed nowhere, wanted to be hermetically sealed in its own art historical tradition. It was figurative, it foregrounded the body. There were a lot of bodies demonstrated motion and rest in socialist realism. What I find interesting is that the realism is not a naturalism in the sense of French realism, but a forced future projected optimism. It was like a staging of a time that wasn't necessarily here, but a time to come of like a communist utopia. At the Soviet Writers' Congress in 1934, they stated that this art was supposed to be anti-pessimistic, anti-individualistic. It had an objective truth or specific truth and a typification of heroes in the making. It was said at that conference, socialist realism means not only knowing reality as it is, but knowing where it is moving. It is moving towards socialism. It is moving towards the victory of the international proletariat. Stalin described the practitioners of socialist realism as engineers of souls, which I think is pretty metal. And kind of reminds me of an Enlightenment idea of metanoia, the idea of transformation from transition from an old identity to a new one. So it makes me think of the potentials that people saw in both politics and religion to like wholly transform somebody's soul to like redirect their purpose. I think that was influenced by the mass media and reproduction. Boris Logenson at the Convention of Soviet Artists in the 1930s described this new style as staging a picture or a virtual photograph, which is something that has always stuck with me. Unlike art of the past, socialist realism was not created for galleries or private collections, but for the masses to be educated, inspired, and directed. Socialist realism was produced and reproduced on a mass scale comparable to only the photographic and cinematic production in the West. We'll get to this more later. So I'll jump to Vietnam. Here are a couple other examples of sort of the myth-making and typification of heroes that I was talking about. So to jump to Vietnam, for several decades since the 1940s, Vietnam's artistic production was dominated by the Democratic Republic of Vietnam's, which I'll call DRVN's, administration of revolutionary art that derived from Maoist and Stalinist socialist realism. Ho Chi Minh was influenced by a number of international events in the first half of the 20th century, such as the success of the October Revolution in Russia in 1917, the growth of the Red Army of Mao Zedong's in 1940s, and the foundation of the People's Republic in China in 1949. In August 1945, the Viet Minh League of Independence of Vietnam defeated the French troops in Hanoi, Hue, and Saigon, victories that allowed Ho Chi Minh to declare Vietnamese independence. As part of the nation's total communist reconstruction, the DRVN initiated the first stage of a decades-long overhaul of cultural production that reoriented artists and writers as public messengers of the national agenda. So in his article, To Increase Morality of the Revolution, To Wipe Out Individualism, HCM, which is Ho Chi Minh, and I started by just calling him Min, and it really confused me. especially because he like says amazing things that I don't agree with. So HCM states that the morality of the revolution was collectivism, unity, organization, and discipline. He was really influenced by Lenin's rhetoric of unity in his text, Party Organization, Party Literature. So he implored Vietnamese people to consider all of their endeavors, including their creative endeavors, to be one for all. Reflecting Maoist communism, and where this is a little different than the Stalinist socialist realism, HCM rationalizes that the service of literature and art to politics in order to achieve liberation from Western occupation. So as I mentioned earlier, like this is the aspect of Vietnamese communism that is positioned against the West that I think makes for interesting consequences later when Vietnam is now trying to adapt to a new Western global art market. Vietnam too believed that the concept of collectivism would provide a solution for the survival of the country, and literature should take place in the struggle for national independence. Like China, Vietnam's proletarian cultural narrative was rooted in anti-imperialism that was born out of a patriotism and egalitarianism. Presented with the challenge to instill the ideals of a workers' revolution in a country with a low literacy level, the DRVN saw in socialist realism an attractive model. For the DRVN, embracing the systematization of politics was beneficial on many levels. The adoption of socialist realism would align Vietnam with the international agenda of the communist bloc, specifically with the Soviet Union and the People's Republic of China. And Ho Chi Minh was like very into aesthetics that were outside of the art and literature of Vietnamese people too. So other examples was he imposed aesthetic uniformity in the way he dressed and in the way he had people who worked for him dress, like the men in Mao jackets, the women in black trousers and Mao jackets. So uniformity was just like a really big overarching political strategy for him. So HCM not only derided formal artistic experimentation as libertine individualism, but emblematic of the corrupt bourgeois decadence of the West. HCM's distaste was cemented into national policy when he visited this exhibition at the Cultural Association for National Salvation in 1945, where all these Vietnamese people like like lily blossoms and like other artworks that they had sort of adapted from the erstwhile French school of art that was influencing Vietnam when he dropped this devastating backhanded comment. All these paintings are very beautiful, but are upper class beauties. Why don't we make paintings about lower class beauties around us? At the National Conference, at the National Cultural Conference in 1948, Trung Chinh, the General Secretary of the DRVN, delivered Marxism in Vietnamese Culture, a paper that set the golden standard for artists and writers over the next 40 years. Chinh, whose cultural perspectives and policies were so extreme to earn the nickname Cultural Tsar, echoed the parameters set forth by the Soviet Writers' Congress, announcing that literature must achieve three objectives: national, technical, and popular. Specifically denouncing Western modernism, he argued that Cubism, Impressionism, Surrealism, and Dadaism were sprouted from the rotten wood of imperialist culture. Another example of his extreme policies was he banned the eye, like usage of the eye in writing for a while too, and banned a bunch of books. The socialist realist artist Tu Moc Vang was highly regarded by the party, who appointed him director of the Fine Arts School of Viet Bac in the resistance zone in 1950. They banned nudes, they banned still lifes, they banned abstract art due to its relation to Western modernism. So radical intellectuals, writers, and artists who had been working there before were demanded to get out of their ivory towers. So again, this was very, like, the demand to stop being so individualistic and, like, quote unquote, get out of their ivory towers was very related to sort of trying to reprogram people to think about making work for everybody to understand. And everything that was seen as, like, a little opaque was seen as an abandonment of the public. At the conference, Chinh again brings up that objective truth thing that I think they really borrowed from Stalinist socialist realism, where they talk about objective truth. So he says, there are objective truths which are unfavorable to us. For example, shall we report a battle we have lost truthfully? We can, of course, depict a lost battle, but in doing so, we must see to it that people realize how heroically our combatants accepted sacrifices, why the battle was lost. It should be borne in mind that there are truths worth mentioning, and there are also truths which are better left unmentioned, at least temporarily, and if mentioned at all. The question is where and how they should be revealed. I think this is so, like, annoying to hear, and I don't know, it's, like, the objective truth part has always stuck with me because it's so, like, gaslighty. It's, like, a really gaslighty part of socialist realism where it's, like, the truth that everybody knows that it's not, and artists are supposed to be messengers of the truth, but they also know that it's not the truth yet. So it has, like, pedagogical, morale-boosting elements to it that are called truth to instill hope in the public, to prime them for, like, the near future of communism. People have called it doctrinaire realism, which I think is helpful. So Chinh, the cultural czar, works through an intricate network of front organizations, writing for newspapers such as Flags of Liberation. Borrowing from techniques developed by the Soviet Union, agitprop units produce newspapers, posters, pamphlets, photographs, and films. In the 1950s, Chinh created a propaganda poster bureau in the Department of Information and Propaganda, and the provisional government of the DRVN took over the Vietnam University of Fine Arts. As a person who is just looking online for these sources and maybe doesn't have access to, like, academic archives, it's really hard to find photos of Vietnamese socialist realism that is, like, high-res as cited. Things are really poorly cited. Even in academic articles, they're using what look like Google screen caps. Like, it's just so blurry. And there are, like, the only high-res photos that you can find, or that I could find, were in books that they currently sell in Vietnam that are sort of like propaganda redux collections, like collections of, like, not in art historical way, but just sort of like collections of these posters that are sort of like, look at these beautiful illustrations of my nation's and its values. And so I bought a bunch of these when I was in Vietnam, and this is a scan from one of them. I can't remember what this says, but I think it says, like, we're, like, so so eager to fight our enemies or something like that, which is like standard rhetoric, but it's showing like a bunch of different kinds of Vietnamese people around, like with smiles on their faces, talking about how eager they are to like fight for their country. And when I bought this in Vietnam, my grandma was super alarmed because she like grew up during this time and still has this idea of like, government impositions on ideas and art, and she was like, you can't bring that back. And I was like, don't worry about it. Like, people talk about all sorts of things in America. But she was like really scared, so she hid them from me, and I like found them, and I was like, I'm gonna bring these back. And she was like, if anybody finds the books in your house, you have to tell them that you just, like, someone just left it there, and you have like no idea where it came from. And I like, even, yeah, it was such a wrestle. I even tried at one point to explain Twitter to her. I was like, maybe if she sees my Twitter and like the kinds of things people are talking about on there, like about communism, she'll understand, but that didn't seem very fruitful. But as another aside, when I moved into a house 6 years ago, someone did leave a bunch of Chinese Cultural Revolution propaganda in my room. So, and including like these beautiful agriculture posters from the Cultural Revolution, which I like hang up in my bedroom now. So it's not unprecedented, and it wouldn't be a lie to say that I did just find this propaganda. maybe their grandma scared them. So stuff like this is like, it was like mainly anonymous. Like people sort of went to schools like the Resistance School of Fine Art and the Provisional Jungle Schools, which you may have heard are just like people making work like in plein air, in the battlefields and stuff. So there's a bunch of similar works as this, and since artists had, this is actually just my guess, but since artists had such tight time frames which to effectively create and mass produce decipherable visual information, and because they were trying to make work for illiterate populations, the resulting prints can be characterized by a sparsely detailed printmaking style. There is less of the like painterly works in Vietnamese socialist realism and more of these like printmaking illustrative cartoon styles. So to bounce around a little, to think about the geopolitical uses of art, I find it very helpful to think about like the CIA's use of abstraction in America around the same time as their own political propaganda, mainly around abstract expressionism. It's come out in the past decades that the CIA funded a lot of abstract expressionist art, and which means like they were on, there was some overlap between MoMA curators and people who worked in the CIA. There was a bunch of acquisitions that the CIA made of a bunch of abstract expressionist paintings that just sort of live in their archives, and people have tried to go in there and figure out like what they're doing with it. It's kind of unclear. But, and I think that's really interesting. It is different than like the Soviet Union sanctioning and imposing this art direction. It's not quite like that, but it does show a sort of investment in the ideological messaging in art. So in abstract expressionism, it wasn't didactic. And by abstract expressionism, I didn't put up a slide in here, but I think you all, if you've all thought about art or looked into art, I think you've definitely seen it. It's like Pollock's paints, splatters, Rothko's like stratas of colors with like the blues and the umber oranges. And I think why it's so prevalent too, it's like the first thing that you might have encountered when you think about art history, which I think is interesting and like sort of related to all of this like American investment in it. So it wasn't didactic, it was absorbed in its own possibilities. And by that I mean like, as opposed to this where it's kind of like anonymous and all looks the same, like a Pollock looks like a Pollock and a Rothko looks like a Rothko. So like the thrill there was artists who could create their own worlds that you can like dive in and live in. Versus all these paintings that look the same. It was non-figurative and politically silent, seemingly, which was sort of its sell. It was the antithesis of socialist realism. So in the past decades, like people who worked for the CIA and other art historians have come out and really expanded our knowledge about like the points to which the CIA was involved in these art forms and in like the formation of New York as like a major hub for this kind of abstract art. So according to writer James Petras, what the CIA saw in abstract expressionism, which was deemed as America's avant-garde movement, was an anti-communist ideology, the ideology of freedom and free enterprise. In the propaganda war with the Soviet Union, this new artistic movement could be held as proof of creativity and intellectual freedom. When the CIA was founded in 1947, the agency set up a division called Propaganda Assets Inventory, which at its peak could influence more than 800 newspapers, magazines, and public information organizations. Later it became the Congress for Cultural Freedom, set up with CIA funds in the 50s. So there were traveling shows, such as the New American Painting Show and Masterpieces of the 20th Century, that toured internationally to European cities to just sort of to spread like all of this freedom of expression that was happening in America. The CIA also published and translated well-known authors who towed the Washington line and sponsored abstract art to counteract with art with any social content, and throughout the world subsidized journals that criticized Marxism, communism, and revolutionary politics. Some people who study socialist realism claim that this like counter CIA project is a big part of why we feel like it was so totalitarian and feel like it was like a harsher regime, like communism was a harsher regime than it is, and that is sort of up for interpretation. I'm not sure. So the CIA funded magazines such as the Parisian Review, Kenyon Review, New Leader, Encounter, and when this all came out, some people deny that they ever knew that it was being bankrolled by the CIA, and some people were like, we talked about it every meeting, so that is sort of the way. You know, the others could be like, oh, I just wasn't at that meeting, sorry. We're just pure. But the CIA was particularly interested in and promoted the democratic left and ex-leftists, so like they picked like free thinkers who were left-leaning to show that you could be leftist and anti-communist. Like you could be radical, but like, you know, you draw the line at communism because you also really valued creative expression. They promoted symphonies, art exhibits, ballets, theater groups, jazz performers. So that's sort of the art during communism part. To go back to Vietnam, although the restrictions on cultural production have drastically loosened since the Reformation period, which was in the 80s, revolutionary art continues to prevail today in Vietnam. As shown by my anecdote with my grandma, like that's still very much how art is perceived, and there's still sort of this like tacit fear around abstract art, because most art is administered by the Vietnamese governmental cultural ministry. So to explain the Reformation period really quick, the term renovation refers to the economic and political reforms that began in 1986, where the General Secretary of the Communist Party tried to move away from centralized control towards a market economy in order to rescue the country from economic and political crisis. So after that period, the literary and cultural activity was dramatically changed. People took this opportunity to explore a wider range of new themes, to experiment with new styles of writing, and delineate objective truth. So, like, that period was a huge relief for artists and writers who obviously felt so repressed at the time. And, like, I think about all of the propaganda that was happening in America to sort of endorse the freedom of individual expression that was seen in abstraction, and I can't help but wonder if like that sort of had an impact too on how young Vietnamese people are thinking about art, because right now everybody is interested in entering, like I said, this international global art market that is very much in the lineage of that abstract freedom of expression idea. So I'm going to talk about two works that I think demonstrate how Vietnamese artists are talking about the complexity of all these ideas. And one of the works, I regret to inform you that I forgot to put in the slides for it, But I can describe it very vividly if you want to close your eyes. So I've been focusing on these artists from Vietnam who are currently making work and are sort of the most visible, or like among the most visible in terms of the international art market. So I focus on the Propeller Group and Tuan Andrew Nguyen, who is part of the Propeller Group but also makes work by himself. So for the first piece I'm going to talk about, it's called Proposals for a Vietnamese Landscape. And for these series of paintings, Nguyen collaborated with graffiti artists and a replica painter who previously painted signs for the communist government. The painting styles highlight two distinct contrasting styles in Vietnamese art history, the French-influenced pictorial language of oil painting and the printmaking style of revolutionary art. In one painting, which is rendered photorealistically in oil paint, it's a vacant street, there's nobody on it. There, you can see an LG Electronics billboard sign with the slogan, "Life's Good," erected right next to a government placard that features a one-party system, its typical tropes. The Democratic Republic of Vietnam's flag, the hammer and sickle symbol, a phrase that translates to "do as the uncle says, propel the country's industrialization and modernization." And it's a really accurate depiction of what Vietnam still looks like today, where you have a bunch of commercial placards next to a bunch of old billboards from that communist regime. So there are five paintings in the series. Another one, in like a similar fashion, is a Yamaha advertisement, which features a woman reclining on a motorcycle, an image that foregrounds a luxe vacation abode with tough palm trees next to a placard with a close band of workers peering towards a row of industrial factories. The specifics differ between the paintings, but all the works in the series elucidate the juxtaposition of the competing visual campaigns that are still playing out in Vietnam. The present-day campaigns have inherited a stylistic and thematic element of the DRVN's adoption of socialist realism, figurative in its renderings of people and objects and conservative in line work and color palette. And the thing that I think is really interesting about Tuan Andrew Nguyen and the Propeller Group's work is because there's still so much censorship around work, they have to make work that looks like it will pass for something else, so which is why I'm bringing up the painting style. Like, the painting style sort of looks like the French tradition. So if somebody saw it, they'd just be like, this is just like a portrait of what the current streets look like and not necessarily like commentary on like social and political situations. So they can kind of like hang it up in galleries and people can look at it. And if you want to talk more about it with them, you can, but it's not necessarily like an overt piece of political art. So they draw a lot of connections between commercialism and the communism regime of the Ho Chi Minh era. In an essay, Avant-Garde Kitsch by Clement Greenberg, he writes that mass kitsch uses the effects of art, whereas the avant-garde investigates artistic devices. He places socialist realism and other forms of totalitarian art on par with the commercial mass culture of the West. All of these movements share the common campaign to exert an effect on the maximum audience. Like Greenberg's observation of the similar strategic modes between Western commercial mass culture and totalitarian art, Nguyen magnifies these similarities to not only overlap, but have evolved to present-day iterations that complement one another in Vietnam. So it doesn't even matter that they are competing strategies anymore. They're all just sort of like coexisting on the streets. I think these works are really good explorations of the psychology of both propaganda and advertisements, and by propaganda, I mean political propaganda, and drawing connections between state-manufactured desire and market-manufactured desire for the social and individual body. And then I'll show this other work. Can I play the video, please? So I'll show this other video first. It's a short video called Television Commercial for Communism, which the Propeller Group made in 2011 that showed at the New Museum's 2012 triennial exhibition, The Ungovernables. We'll play it first and then I'll talk about what I got out of it. Thank you.
Solomon Pledge.
That everyone is equal.
That equal opportunities are had by all.
Like Nguyen's collaboration with the replica painter for proposals for a Vietnamese landscape, TPG's collaboration grants the project the appearance of a state approval project at first blush. Government regulations on commercial projects are less stringent than those on conceptual art proposals, which often results in mountains of paperwork, which usually get denied. So strategically, the Propeller Group also brands themselves as an entertainment video production company, so they also make a bunch of music videos for Vietnamese pop stars. In an interview with Bomb Blog, TPG states that working in media and advertising has given us a vantage point from which we can explore the strategies involved in the creation and widespread dissemination of ideas, and it's not much different than propaganda. There is an animatic, which I don't really understand, like commercial video production, but there's a part that is also part of the project where it's sort of like a bunch of mood boards for like a earlier version of this video where it's a cartoon. And in the cartoon, there's this girl who is passing out these smile cutouts that like look very much like something you'd see in an Apple campaign. Like everybody is in black and white. And she's passing out these like colorful rainbow smile cutouts and everybody holds them and then everybody joins them together and forms that circle. So the smile cutout to me was always an allegory of utopian optimism and evocative of the communistical icon, which suggests a fully elaborated program for a future society where even affects can be egalitarianism. And what I picked up from this video too that I find interesting is the emphasis of the like current existing family units, like the nuclear family of the parents and two children featured dressed in clinical white and gathered around the dining table. The camera zooms across frozen actors with grins while a voiceover recites the preambles that mimic the Constitution of the United States of America, beginning with "We the People," and then different voices recite each line of the pledge. "We all make the same living, share the same world, live as one and speak the language of smiles." And it makes me think about the differences and similarities of how different political parties regard the body, and how there's a sort of like low-key eugenics in all of it. The low-key eugenics in fascism, red fascism, which a lot of people call communism and capitalism, and how people are always drawing similarities between Stalin and Hitler's political campaigns, in that their agendas created clear uses of the gendered body. As an example, Anatoly Lunacharsky, the appointed head of the People's Commissariat for Enlightenment, when he was conceiving socialist realism with a bunch of people from the party, decided that the direction of art should create a clear system of aesthetics based on the human body. So he said that the aesthetics should show the sight of a healthy body, intelligent face, or friendly smile. And like we've seen from other artworks, like all the bodies are super able-bodied, because they're required to do all sorts of things like work in the fields, have a family, take care of their family, pass on their genes. Lenin called the new Soviet man the perfect person, which is an entirely new type of human being. And I draw connections between this and Hitler's aestheticization of the healthy body, where Hitler has famously said things like, "The German boy must be slim with long limbs, rapid as a hare, tough as leather, solid as steel." And it also makes me think of like contemporary pejoratives of SJWs or social justice warriors from the alt-right, which are all sort of around like lacking libidinal energy or like implications, if not outright accusations of impotence, such as like new males, soy boys, cucks, alphas and betas. And it makes me think of how fascism, communism, and capitalism in practice have embodied these national social forms of Darwinism, the mobilization of the revolutionary demands towards showmanship, the need to turn the lack of material resources into a drama of presence and absence that are charged with sexual intensity. To wrap up with the work from the Propeller Group, I find it a very interesting example of what current Vietnamese people are making work for. So the Propeller Group has shown that video at numerous American galleries, and they are still half live in Vietnam, but like aren't as prominent there or a lot more careful about their work there. And I find that a super interesting dynamic too, if just in terms of thinking about the pivoting of audience and like who they're making work for and who they're criticizing in their work. There's still this sort of uneven relationship between people from post-communist countries, especially from third world countries, making work for the international global art market. I'll tie this up with a quote from President Calvin Coolidge, weirdly. In a 1926 speech, he inadvertently paralleled Stalin's assertion that socialist realism artists can engineer the human soul by pronouncing advertising as the next great transformation machine. He says that advertising is the spiritual side of trade. It is all part of the greater work of regeneration and redemption of mankind. So Tuan Andrew Nguyen in the Propeller Group collapses these promotional strategies into themselves, illuminating the contemporary mutant hydra of late capitalism and communism. Through their projects, they propose counter-narratives unmired in the anarchic language of revolution and negotiate the borders between collective and private, entertainment and politics, national and global, and question the very possibility of a fixed cultural origin. Thanks.
With regards to the question of freedom of expression and communism, What is the possibility for that? I think there is a lot of possibility for it myself. I am a working class person. I am blue collar. I work with my hands all the time, houses. And the thing is, like, you don't see a lot of artwork in this country, in our society, that venerates working class people. I mean, who do you think built like this, the very thing we're standing in? You know, it's just people laying bricks and putting in mortar. And quite frankly, I think that's it's a good thing to see. With freedom of expression, hopefully we can see that develop, but certainly we are always, whatever society we live in, the prevailing dominant forms of culture are what will always be the ones that exert the most influence, and try to create a sort of emancipatory or revolutionary artwork that represents people and their aims and the aspirations of the new society. I think that the possibility for that can only come over an extended period of time with new generations. It might be simple in form, and on the onset it might be fraught with complications, and perhaps may not always be the most tasteful thing to our sensibilities many, many years later. But at the same time, it's with the beauty scenes in terms of becoming and not necessarily being. And that's why I think there is a lot of potential for freedom of expression as well as companies.
Thank you.
That's no question.
No, it's fine.
Is
anybody else's thoughts?
Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think that's really
cool.
And I just don't think I have enough background knowledge on it. When your grandma said to be careful of who sees the book you had, what's the feeling around that? Is it for shame? Is it for you're not supposed to have this now in the present? Why is that exactly?
No, it's not shame. It's
I'm not
because
sure.
The government in Vietnam heavily surveils people, and specifically artists. Like the Propeller Group was absolutely surveilled there. And even when I went to visit them at their house, they were like, "You're probably on a list because they got to their house." And they like the dynamic there right now is there are a couple of contemporary art galleries that sometimes have conceptual shows, like light shows or sound shows, and the government will just like come and take the equipment. Not always, but it will just happen. Like that's sort of the dynamic that she is afraid of happening. And because she's lived there all her life, she can't really imagine a place where that doesn't happen. When I'm just like openly carrying these books and like talking about the same things that I like would be very advised to not talk about in public there. I don't know, but like that sounded really fear-mongering, and it is like a horrible situation, but it's kind of like when I heard that, I feel like it's the kind of dormant surveillance that we probably have with the NSA here, you know, like we are probably on a bunch of lists, and whether or not that will come to like fuck us up later, who knows? It might for some, it might never for some. So I don't know, I'm just saying that because I'm not trying to paint a picture of the Vietnamese government as being like more extreme than it would be here or elsewhere. It's just differently extreme.
Yeah, I think it's a form of expression where certain forms of speech here, there's things you don't say on a plane, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I guess is what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
So a conversation around creativity and art. Okay.
Yeah, just jumping off that, how would you feel like talking about social media and Twitter says that, oh, it's hate speech and it's just people talking.
I'm sorry,
about.
Can you speak?
Sorry. Just recently, Twitter has gotten more harsh about what they consider hate speech, and like they won't like deactivate white supremacist accounts, but will turn around it and be like, this is like super leftist. It gets their account blocked or suspended for 2 weeks. I wonder if that's something similar that the U.S. government or that.
Yeah, you made a really stark distinction. When you brought up the CIA, you made it seem like you felt the American social formation around surveillance and the Vietnamese one were super different. But I see them as fairly similar, maybe more like America. It's like a tyranny of choice,
mm-hmm.
right? And the surveillance is maybe less out in the open, right? Do you feel like it is that stark, or is there more overlap than?
Yeah, I don't think I said it's that stark. I said I have a feeling it's just like different shades
mm-hmm.
of surveillance and kind of like there it's just really, really overt that it's the Vietnamese cultural ministry is going to knock on your door, whereas I feel like here it's even like more abstract than that. You don't really know who is really going to vote for. But I am not an expert on surveillance. So.
Kind of a non-question, but thanks for the presentation. This makes me think of a related topic, given the industry where I work, which is related to advertising. When I see these examples, you know, from the past, the things I'm mostly worried about is what the types of propaganda that we'll see in the future, and they're already happening. So for example, this makes me think of a story that broke recently about this firm, Cambridge Analytica, where they were creating personalized images and articles that would cater to one part of the population. So in the same way where a regime would like to portray society like for the whole country, you know, like they would fund, like you said, the CIA would fund the, you know, this sort of expression because it orients people this way. In the future, we might see that every section of the population would have its own form of propaganda that is just specialized for it. So is this something you thought of? You know, like basically personalized advertising.
Yeah. Also, if it would be really helpful to me if people just like jumped in and responded to each other, it would take the onus off me a little bit. I think that's, I've had more analyses on the Propeller Group, which I didn't really want to get into, but I think that's a big part of their project of like blurring their political work and their commercial work so much is that they were like, there was a bunch of psychological research and development around the like how to change people's psychologies, and it was just either applied through political regimes, or it was applied through commercialism, and you kind of saw that develop around the same time, like in the 30s and the 40s. So they draw a lot of connections to that. And I think it's really interesting that they partnered with the people who did the Apple Think Different campaign, because I feel like part of like advertising's rhetorical draw is related to this like individual freedom of expression. Like, you can buy all these products to like form like more perfect, unique you, which is like a million different facets that is like in these ways different than other people's. So, you know, it was kind of like that video we watched where it was sort of like a collective campaign, but it was also about your choice to buy into that if you wanted to.
So like with with people viewing the communism, the Propeller Group ad or art piece, what is the mainstream opinion of that in Vietnam?
Okay,
there is
none.
Yeah.
Did you say you're
going to
respond?
I said I have a feeling there is none.
There's not as much of a reception for it. Like I was talking about with International Art English, like that is still, like the kinds of frameworks that they're building around talking about these things is like a Western audience is very receptive to it, which is why it's like shown at the Guggenheim, the Mistake Room, the New Museum Triennial, and they're like, people are like, have no idea what they're doing, or people are like, you're an advertising group and you made this like weird video that we don't get for someone. I don't know, I don't really know what to think about that dynamic. I think it kind of weirds me out. I was just gonna say, like, a lot of the art schools there are still, like, very formal schools where they train you to paint landscapes and they train you with these, like, painting techniques, and then you have these, like, rogue contemporary art centers with mainly, what do you call those people? Expats, with, like, mainly, like, European and like mainly white-looking experts, I don't know where they come from, like Australia or something, and are like giving young Vietnamese people like all this like critical theory that is still very much originated from like Western canons, and are like, this is how you want to talk if you are trying to
like make a name out of yourself as an international artist. And I think all that is super true. I'm not saying you're like indoctrinating them. I think they're giving them very good advice if they do want to show at like big museums and like have big international partnerships. But I think, again, it just like vexes me that sort of like audience orientation, like who are you making these works for? How are you talking about your country to people not from your country? And like what are the ramifications of that like long term?
Yeah, it reads so satirical for to like a Western, at least in my perspective.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if anybody else felt that.
Yeah, that of like the sort of different level to like make a commercial, it's like everyone should be the same. It's pretty ironic. It's a terrible level of parts.
Any other questions?
Are they showing any other places in either Southeast Asia or East Asia?
I think they've been in a couple of like Asian biennials, like the Singapore biennial. I'm sure they're involved in those.
I was thinking about like what the difference between a Western art audience and that Europeans audience versus like another Southeast Asian or East Asian audience, and what the perception is like in those countries.
I think like it, in like robust Asian programs like the Singapore Biennial, like they are already participating in international art English. Like they're maybe framing the works different and the, like the art histories are different, but it is like out of that same theoretical canon. You know, I don't like, I feel like it's not about where, not necessarily like where the projects are from, but like whether or not it's like couched in an art historical tradition or like couched in an art context, a contemporary art context.
This thing about how University of Iowa type MFA like creative writing programs were developed during the McCarthy era as a like antidote to social realist writing. But I imagine what you're saying is true.
Mm-hmm.
That there was a level of censorship and state sanctioned mm-hmm. narratives that were allowed in writing.
Can you imagine like a time span of a couple years when like no one could write using I? Like that just looks like
could you speak using I? Because I know in Cambodia you weren't allowed to do that.
I think this doctrine was particular to writing.
Okay, got it. I was really interested in how we talked about the difference between like the methods of dissemination, right? So like the communist kind of model roles, like the government both like dictating the values and creating the desire for those, right? Manufacturing desire, whereas in more Western individualism, the government was kind of dictating and helping manufacture, but the method of distributing that manufacturing was much more abstract. It was via market mechanisms. And I think, yeah, the really interesting part about the commercial issue to me was how it played with those different models of communicating and like manufacturing desire. But also I was wondering now, since it's like playing on Apple and stuff, do you have a sense of how this group uses like the internet and
like said things like this video's on Vimeo, like the whole video. I think that is as far as they talked about it, but like not in ways that like necessarily struck out to me, but, like different than how everybody else sees it. I mean, I think the connection with Apple's Think Different campaign is really interesting because I think the Think Different campaign sort of came out of like this moment of like tech utopianism that was really, really like a resurgence of individualism or like a resurgence of like being able to the freedom to choose, like which is like different from like the tyranny of choice, but like the freedom to like choose all these identities and choose all these options.
Yeah. It's also like this like equalizing force also exists in Apple's marketing where it's like it's kind of like everybody's drinking the same Coke. Everybody, you know, like Mark Zuckerberg has an iPhone. I have an iPhone. You know, people poorer than me have iPhones. And it's like this kind of vision of the future that kind of exists with that decodism, which I think is like really smart of them to kind of attack.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's also kind of the like aspect of tech utopianism that is like distributed, like remix-based culture where like everyone can contribute and also consume. Right? And I'm like really curious how they would think about that aspect.
Should we end it?
Sorry.
Should we end it?
Okay. I have one more question.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you, Min. Thank you, Fry. Thank you, Nagara, and the tech people, and the audience, and Victoria, and Jamandir. And Carla. Good job, man.